Well, good evening, everyone. And thank you for joining us tonight for the second event in the Stead Family Chair on International Philanthropy Lecture Series. My name is Lane Benjamin, and I'm an associate professor in philanthropic studies and the director of the doctoral program here at the Lilly Family School of Philanthropy. This evening, I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker, Dr. Kenneth Prewitt, who will be giving a talk entitled, Can Foundations Know If They're Making a Difference? Navigating Between Ivory Towers and Performance Metrics. Dr. Prewitt has had a long and storied career, spanning multiple sectors, from higher education to private foundations to the federal government. He has had numerous experiences and perspectives to draw upon. Currently, Dr. Prewitt serves as the Carnegie Professor of Public Affairs and the Director of the Scholarly Knowledge Project and Special Advisor to the President at Columbia University. Dr. Prewitt previously served as the Director of the United States Census Bureau, an experience that inspired the writing of his recent book, What is Your Race? The Flawed Effort of the Census to Classify Americans. He has also worked in private philanthropy, serving as the vice president for the Rockefeller Foundation. And throughout his career, Dr. Prewitt has been recognized as a true authority in the field. He has received both a prestigious Guggenheim Fellowship and a lifetime career award from the American Political Science Association. This talk is sure to be both engaging and enlightening. So I ask all of you to join me in welcoming Dr. Kenneth Prewitt.
Well, thank you. I hope I earned that. We'll do a performance metric later in the talk. Look, here I think is the problem, or one of the problems. We, and I use the word we to describe people in this room, and a lot of other people could have been in this room, and the academic community, and science, and so forth. So it's a big we. We know this much about something that matters to us. Intolerance, terrorism, how children learn, health conditions. And on any one of those things, about this much is used in dealing with those problems. Does that ring true? That we know more than is being used by our societies, our governments, our NGOs, and so forth and so on? So there's a kind of a gap between what could be used and what is being used. And that bothers people. And people now want to go out and try to measure that and figure out how to close that gap. So that's just my first overall observation to make, but keep it in mind as we go on. Now, the title includes two terms, ivory tower and performance metrics. Ivory tower is actually biblical, references purity, virginal purity, a Song of Solomon. It migrates into higher education many centuries later. And it stood for a kind of a protected space, a space where academics, scholars, intellectuals would be kind of protected from religious dogma, from commercial pursuits, from political pressures. So they were free of all of those kinds of things in order to lead the life of the mind, in order to do science for the sake of science and art for the sake of art in its own terms, because it's enormously important in creating what we came to understand as the Enlightenment and so forth. So that's the word ivory tower. The other word in the title is performance metrics. Now, what I mean by performance metrics is all that stuff we talk about endlessly now. We talk about impact, we talk about consequences, outcomes, outputs, practicality. We talk about we are going to improve philanthropy to improve the world. Well, So we now have to figure out how to, dare I say it, measure whether the world got improved because we improved philanthropy. And that's the bind, that's the challenge we set for ourselves. So performance metrics, I just use as umbrella term for this moment in our own evolution as an academic community, when we really swim in a world of quantification of everything, if at all possible. Let's get a measure of how well we're doing, set a target for ourselves, use that target to measure whether we're going forward and so forth and so on. These are two very different terms, and they both float in and out of our mindset as we think about what we are engaging in. Now, we created in this country a science, I'll use the word science very broadly, truly in the German sense of Wissenschaft, which is all the sciences and all the forms of scholarly knowledge, from humanities, history, literary criticism, all the way over to physics and math and so forth. So I just use the word very broadly, scholarly science, scholarly knowledge, and so forth. We created in this society a platform for producing new knowledge at the end of the Second World War that actually has worked very well. That platform was based upon what the country had learned during the war. One, scientists were loyal. They dropped what they were doing. They went en masse to government laboratories and agencies and focused on the war effort. Secondly, they produced. They gave us radar. They gave us the atomic bomb. They gave us weapons of all sorts of sophistication. They also gave us how to do supply lines. They gave us regional studies. All the sorts of things that went into the war effort, scientists produced. And third, scientists, I use again that word very broadly, academics, had internal processes to self-police. That is, they had ways to find the very best, to fund the very best, and get rid of the junk at the edges, and to make sure there was no corruption, there was no self-dealing, there's no conflicts of interest. So we created a science policy on the basis of those three lessons. That science policy rested upon the proposition that you could give money to the scientific community, to research universities, and not have to micromanage them, because they had internal processes to take care of those kinds of things. And it was an easy sell. It was a very easy sell in 1945 when Vannevar Bush wrote the report called Science, the Endless Frontier, that led to the NSF and tons of money flowing to research universities in the United States and so forth and so on. Essentially, it borrowed from the ivory tower metaphor, the idea of autonomy, that somehow this country would benefit enormously if it created an autonomous space, an autonomous set of rules, an autonomous capacity in the scientific community to continue to do the good work that it had done during the war. That science policy is deeply frayed today. Point one, it's not so clear to the American public, who are putting the taxpayer dollars into the funding of research universities, that scientists actually care so much about the country. They seem to care about themselves. They write books for each other, and then they go fancy places and talk about these books. They take the summer off, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And it turns out they don't even produce that much. They do produce some things, but most of that goes into commercial profits. We haven't got the right kinds of policies. We don't have the right kinds of social practices in this society. If they're so, why aren't we making more headway? Why is there a gap between how much we know and how much is being used? And third, we're not even sure that they self-police that well. There are conflict of interest. There's questions about replication. There are fraud. The press is full of all those kinds of stories. So there's been a real fraying of what had been the science policy that we put in place in 1945, out of which the philanthropic world grew in part. It took off after the war, as we know. We had a big philanthropic sector and foundation sector, obviously starting the first of the century, but it really began to expand enormously. So it expands during this period, and that becomes quite important in a second. Now, What I think is happening in so-called our in the larger world of science policy is the autonomy regime that had been put in place with very lightly administered accountability. I'm now going back to the 1950s and 60s and so forth. Very lightly administered accountability is now being recalibrated, in which accountability is coming up and autonomy is going down. And this moment occurs not because of, but simultaneously with the rise of performance metrics. So not only is autonomy coming up as a key factor in how we think about the production of knowledge and the use of knowledge and so forth, but it's coming up at a moment when we're going to measure this accountability. We're going to put in a metric in order to make sure that people spending taxpayers' dollars are giving us results for the investment that we're making in them. Now stick for a moment foundations into this picture. Foundations are unusually autonomous. They are independent of. They are created to be autonomous. They don't have to produce a product. They don't have to produce a practice. They don't have to produce a policy. They produce whatever they want to produce and hand to the society. And they like autonomy, their own autonomy. However, increasingly, foundations are caught up in the accountability game as well. But it's the grantees they want to hold accountable for how well the grantees do. And that becomes the measure of how well they do. But how well they do in choosing the grantees and so forth is a murky field. And there is no kind of metric for that yet. So we have a funny situation where foundations are positioned and on this landscape, but on this landscape in a way where we're not sort of certain how much of the autonomy that we've given to them we should continue to give to them. So that's the picture. The really good news is I'm going to solve it for you. It sounds like a problem. It sounds like we got this tension. We're not doing very well. We don't know what kind of who to count on, who to have confidence in, and so forth. But I take this very seriously. I really think that we need a new understanding in the society, a new, if you will, social contract between, on the one hand, the people who pay for research, and on the other, the people who produce the research. Between the science and the state, or the science and industry, or the science and the NGO world, the civil society, and what have you, that we need a way to work out what is this relationship in a way that doesn't lose something that has been extremely valuable and yet honors our obligation to be accountable to the taxpayers and the public whose money we are using to do our work, in large part. And I include foundation money in there because, after all, that is partly tax money, as we know, depending on the inheritance tax, the income tax, how it would have come, but it's somewhere between 15 to 35% is, after all, taxpayers' money when foundations are giving money to their grantees and so forth. Okay. Here's, I think, our challenge. The initial science policy of the post-Second World War kind of assumed, in the whole ivory tower metaphor, independence, protection, space, purity, so forth and so on, is kind of based on the assumption that autonomy and accountability are in a zero-sum game. If you have enough of this one, you have less of that one. So that there's a trade-off between those two things, and it makes intuitive sense. You know, if you got a lot of autonomy, you don't need to be accountable because we've got all this autonomy, you've got all this freedom, all this protected space. So we're going to do whatever you want. And on the other hand, on the other hand, if you start pushing accountability up, you've got to answer for yourself, you've got to prove you're producing, you're on a short time lease, and so forth. Then autonomy shrinks, and accountability goes up. So the assumption has been that this is a zero-sum game. And so the rest of my talk is going to be focused on how we make it a positive sum game so that we hold both of those things in some sort of creative tension in such a way that we actually end up better off, both society and the production, the knowledge and the use of knowledge, and we have to get back to why it's not being used in a second. Let's start with autonomy. You really do need some autonomy, serious autonomy, if knowledge is going to produce what it's capable of producing for the society. You do need space for serendipity. A lot of stuff gets discovered accidentally. You do need the capacity to fail in the laboratory and in investigation and so forth. Run an experiment that doesn't work, and only after it doesn't work you decide to run one that might work, and so forth and so on. You actually need some space. You need what the ivory tower metaphor tried to signal. But if you're in an ivory tower, you're not accountable. So just something doesn't add up yet. But here's what I would like to figure out how to add up. Acronyms are risky, but I'm going to risk one. My acronym is USBAR. You've never heard of it. I just invented it. I had to look at my own notes to remind myself what I'd invented. USBAR. USB, unexpected social benefit, AR, appreciated retroactively. Now, in the 1920s, the physicists, mathematicians, gave us quantum physics. It was a really big breakthrough. Today we have Moore's Law. Quantum physics, Moore's Law is simply quantum physics playing itself out in the economy. Quantum physics gave us the IT industry. It gave us our iPhones. It's given huge benefits to this society. It was not in their heads in the 1920s. Eisenberg didn't have the foggiest idea that you would get to something like it we got to. Higgs boson, we just discovered Higgs boson. It is now not being used, but it will be. So first I want to mention a phrase to get rid of it, basic and applied research. I think we have to bury that phrase, quit using it. Instead, think about two kinds of knowledge, but knowledge in two different points on its continuum. Knowledge that is being used and knowledge that is waiting to be used. Quantum physics in the 1920s was in the category of knowledge waiting to be used. By the 1950s, it was knowledge being used. Higgs boson is still in the category of waiting to be used. It will be used. It is so fundamental, it will find uses for itself. The commercial players will find uses. The government will find uses. It will be used because it is such fundamental knowledge you cannot not use it. I'm absolutely convinced of that. I don't know what the lag time is. Lag time could be short, it could be long. Quantum physics lag time is about 30 years. Let me give you a social science example. Early childhood intervention. I can tell you, when I was getting my degree a long time ago, I won't set the date, but a long time ago, early childhood intervention wasn't even a concept, wasn't something we talked about. Even as parents, we didn't sort of vague sort of thing. Early childhood intervention now gives us pre-K education. It gives us parental practices, talking to the baby when it's still in the womb, for heaven's sakes. And we deeply believe in early childhood intervention. But there was a lag time. We cannot be embarrassed by the fact there's a lag time. That's the point. We're going to have to tell our story in such a way that for certain parts of what we do in production of knowledge, we cannot have a performance metric except after the fact. If you demand that we have a performance metric today, you're going to get a shrunken, shallow science. And that's not where the society needs to be. If you want the next big breakthrough like early childhood intervention or quantum mechanics are the double helix in DNA, which has now given us personalized medicine. That lag time, 53 was the Watson-Crick piece, and today we're talking personalized medicine. That's a lag time of over a half century. We have got to go to the country and say, we've got to protect some space for certain kinds of research and knowledge production, because the country is going to be the loser if we don't do this. Not an original argument, by the way. There's pipeline arguments, reports on this, and so forth. But what is original, I think, not original, that's too strong, but what I think is useful, is get rid of the science for science sake vocabulary. Get rid of the, it is not about an ivory tower. It's not about asking for summers off and so forth and that kind of thing. It is about doing our work, but telling you that the benefits of that work are not immediately available to anybody. We haven't seen it yet. But this is knowledge that has a real capacity to become something important. So the first big point, autonomy, is based on the idea that that there is something called usbar science or usbar science. It's unintended social benefits, but appreciated retroactively. I do not think we will be successful in making that argument unless we couple it with an accountability regime. And I just believe that. I just read the tea leaves, or I spend a lot of time in Washington. I just do not think that we can continue to claim the kind of autonomy, independence, give us the money, we know what to do with it, we're scholars and we'll do a good job and we'll solve problems and so forth. I think I've talked too long. And no, it's you can't see. It's a robot. It's coming back. If we don't connect the accountability autonomy regime that we want to an accountability regime, we're not going to get away with it. So now let me talk just a few minutes about. Hope you'll give me a few minutes, about accountability. This will be based upon performance metrics. There is no escaping that. To try to think that you're going to put together an accountability regime that doesn't have metrics is, I think, whistling in the dark. If we're telling the government, please use evidence-based policy, then why can't the government say, well, what we want is an evidence-based accountability regime that tells us if we invest in evidence-based policy, it will be worth the investment. So they have every right to come back when we're asking for taxpayer dollars and telling them how to spend their money. They want to come back and say, well, give us some evidence that will work. So here is what I think we have to do. We have to negotiate a accountability regime based on measurement, based on metrics, based on accountability, based upon impact, based upon outcomes, all that vocabulary. We have to negotiate that and along three dimensions. First, the beauty of science at its best is that its methods are designed to prevent us from self-deception. We start in doing research from the assumption that people want to find the truth, but we're human, we're weak, and so sometimes we kind of want to exaggerate the findings in order to get the publication and whatever and impress the dean and so forth and so on. And what the methodology says is, no, wait a minute. You did not produce that piece of knowledge to the point of validity or reliability or whatever that makes us have confidence in it. And that's what, and that's why you have to run the experiment, or you have to run the regression analysis, or you have to do the data, the dating of the archival findings or the archaeological findings or what have you. You got to show us a methodology that got rid of your personal proclivities or hopes and just let the facts speak for themselves. We have to create a metric system for accountability that doesn't allow us to exaggerate our contribution. And I don't think that's easy. But we really have to do it in such a way that we're saying that we're going to be as ruthless in claiming that we are improving the world as we are that we're improving philanthropy. We have some way to talk about improving philanthropy, and we'll measure that, and we'll do a good job, and the school will be proud of itself because it taught students, and they're better, and so forth and so on. But improving the world is a big jump from that. We have to be just as good at, and just as ruthlessly self-honest about talking about contribution as we did about improving philanthropy. So point one is we have to control our natural tendency to exaggerate. Point two, we have to be really upfront about what can be measured. What can be measured if we work harder at it, but we're not quite doing it well now, and what we really can't measure. So, can I measure the dropout rate? Yeah, pretty well. I can get scientists together, we can drop out the dropout rate, make sure the denominator is right, and so forth and so on. Good. Can I measure value added? It's harder, but it's within reach. If we really go to work on value added, we can figure out a good metric for value added. However, I also say all the time, I'm an educator, I say we will educate the best citizens that this country can possibly have in 30 years. That's an aspiration, that's not a finding. I actually don't know that. So I have to say that. I have to create a metric system for seeing how well we're doing, which really is good at distinguishing what is available and what is available if we work harder at it, but what is simply beyond our measurement capacity right now. And we have to convince the society, convince the Congress, and convince everybody else that we have done a very good job. In effect, what we are saying is that we cannot game the system. We're smart enough to game the system, but if we create a metric system that games the system, we've not played fair, and we will be caught out, and we should be caught out, and so forth. So we got to meet those two criteria. Avoid self-deception, avoid the exaggeration, and don't game the system. Put it out there really candidly. Put it out there candidly, and then we have to live up. We're going to be measured by it, and if we don't live up to it, and I now mean a metric system that talks not just about what do we know, but what is being used of what we know, and if it's not being used, why is it not being used? That's a whole different step, and it's very hard, but if we don't do it, we're not actually, I don't think, playing fair with a taxpayer. So third thing is that, in trying to create this accountability metric system, is that it's really got to work. And it's very difficult. I'm sounding very flippant about this. I don't think it's easy at all. It's got to work the whole gambit of what we do. Biological sciences, physical sciences, social sciences, historical sciences, art history, you know, whatever. It's got to work across a very complicated intellectual landscape. And it's got to work for policy. We're supposed to be telling the country how to have good policy. It's got to work for products. Do the pills work? Do the vaccines work? Do the algorithms work? Do the driverless cars drive safely, et cetera, et cetera? And it's got to work for practice. It's got to work for the civil society. It's got to work for parents making decisions about how to parent. It's got to work for health regimes that people actually live up to and follow the regime so that we will know and so forth and so on. So it's got to work across policy, product, and practice. And across all these disciplines, so it's not a simple task, but I think we're smart enough to do it. So let me just then wrap it up by saying that, almost wrap it up. I hate people say I'm about to finish, then they don't finish. So I'm not about to finish. We have to put together what I've just said, that autonomy, based upon the idea that retroactively appreciated still matters enormously. And we've got to save the space to do that kind of work so that there can be those kinds of social benefits that would be retro, and we can make that story. But we're willing to sign up for a serious accountability regime as well, when we say that we're actually already in the business of giving the social benefit. It's not retroactive anymore. It's the stuff we're doing now. We're improving the schools. We're improving health. We're pushing in everywhere into society, pushing our way, pushing our results, making a difference, claiming that we're making a difference. We have to measure whether we're making a difference or not. We have to measure use, not just the quality of the science, but the magnitude and scope and usefulness of it to people outside of us. Scientists ought to control the science. But the application, the use of the science, can only be controlled by the people who are out there making those decisions. They're deciding to do the product. They're deciding to pass the policy. They're deciding to adopt the practice. It's not our job to tell them that. We can tell the city council that if you build the bridge here, this will happen to the traffic flow. And if you don't want it to fall down, then build this engineering into it. But we can't tell the city council they should build it. That's a political decision. They have to weigh that against all the other kinds of decisions they make. So we got to be very careful about what we can do and what we don't do. This, I think, would create a positive sum game in which the retroactively appreciated will still be in place, but in addition to it, we would have this accountability where we're saying we're making contributions to the society right now, improving all that kind of stuff. We could all go down the list. And we have to put it out there in a way that's honest, that doesn't game the system, and so forth. And therefore, we turn what was zero sum into positive sum. I think if we don't get science policy to that place, that we're in trouble. That we're already in trouble because for all the reasons that you all know. So the final thing I would say then, this is about the school itself and the responsibility of a place like this. The philanthropic sector, as you know quite well, it's positioned in a very complicated space in what I've just gone through. One has to be studied, so we need good research on its characteristics, its ambitions, its accomplishments in its own terms. But we also have to pay a lot of attention to the foundations insofar as they are funding this. A lot of things are funding the philanthropic sector, of course, not just foundations, donations, membership fees, and so forth. But where you have the big players out there saying they're making all this difference, they have got to be subjected to the same kind of regime I just mentioned. They have to be subjected to a regime that says, if we are making this promise, if we are going to eradicate poverty, I don't want to use examples of people in the room. I'm trying to, but they're in my head, and I'm about to come out, and I don't want to do that, et cetera, et cetera. I think the foundations have to be subjected to the same kind of honest metric system about what they say they're doing for the society, as I've said, that we have to more generally. That's the kind of project the school can take on. It can do it about itself, and then it can do it about its target audience. And if you hand that over to the target audience and they adopt it, that is one big accomplishment. That's enough.
Thank you very much, Dr. Poole. We're just going to take a moment to invite our panelists up to continue this wonderful conversation that Dr. Poole has heard and begun for us. I also hope you all took notes because there'll be a quiz about Usbar after the end of the session. So joining us on the panel is Dr. Duane Matthews. He's the Vice President of Strategy Development at the Lumina Foundation. We also are fortunate to have with us Christy Gillespie, Vice President of Community Impact at the United Way of Central Indiana. And finally, we have Dr. Catherine Harold, Assistant Professor of Philanthropic Studies at the Lilly Family School of Philanthropy. So we will start with our foundation representative, Dr. Matthews, to talk a little bit about his reactions to Dr. Prewitt's presentation, and then followed by our representative of somebody who is very close to the agencies that try to deliver impact in the community and make use of philanthropic dollars. And then finally, we will conclude with, if you will, a more academic, scholarly response to Dr. Prewitt's presentation. And we'll allow after that Dr. Prewitt a chance to respond to the comments and then immediately open it up for your questions as well. So, Dr. Matthews.
Thank you. First of all, I love this framing of an issue between autonomy and accountability. So I'll ask the question, is it possible to have voluntary accountability? Or is that just a meaningless phrase? There is, in higher education circles, the national association that actually represents IUPUI is an active, has created this program called the Voluntary System of Accountability, intended to put out a whole set of metrics about the performances of colleges and universities as a voluntary system. Is that a real effort? Is this a show? Is this intended to head off criticism? Or is this a genuine effort at improvement? And not just improvement, but actual accountability. So that's the question. Is that possible to choose to be accountable? I don't know. I think we would reflect on that and say, why not? Don't we teach children to be accountable? Not to be held accountable, but to take accountability on themselves, to choose to be accountable. I think this idea of being accountable as a value is something that that I think we could recognize as being, in fact, very desirable. Can we choose to be accountable? And again, not just report on our metrics, report on what we think are our successes, and perhaps even like some foundations do, report on our failures, but actually hold ourselves accountable for that. Well, what does that take to be actually accountable to oneself or to choose or put accountability on one's own organization, say on a foundation? Well, in our case, you know, we're a foundation that works in higher education. We have a goal, and the goal is that 60% of Americans have a high-quality post-secondary credential by 2025. You've heard of this goal. We take this goal very seriously. When we adopted the goal, I'll be very honest with you, it was seen as sort of, it was a great sort of framing tool. This is what we're about. It's a great way to communicate what needs to happen in this country, to turn our mission of promoting access and success in higher education into something a little more tangible, a little more actionable. We got a new CEO about 8 years ago, who came in and said, you know, I really like this goal, but I actually want us to be accountable to this goal. I want us to make a public statement that this is what we're going to work towards, report our progress against that goal, and say we are accountable for producing that result. This is what we're focused on, and all of our work is going to be oriented around the accomplishment of that. What happened when that happened? Well, some things happened right away, but things are still trickling down from that decision about 8 years ago, and one of them is that we take metrics very seriously. Why? Because we're enamored of metrics. I've not found anybody, except a couple of crazies, a couple of whom are on our board of directors, who love metrics. They're Six Sigma type people. You know? Those people love metrics. I've kind of turned into them, I have to admit. But most people don't love metrics. But when you're focused on a goal, and you know what that goal is, and by the way, one of the, I mentioned earlier, a scary topic is things I learned in grad school. One of the things I learned in grad school was that everybody has goals. And everybody is constantly seeking feedback on their performance towards those goals. In fact, if you want to know what people's real goals are, look at what they're seeking feedback on. And so if you want to know what's a real goal of a university, ask an assistant professor on tenure track, what's the real goal of the university? They'll tell you what the real goal of the university is. I digress. So when the goal is stated and is public and you're truly committed to it and you're truly focused on it, then your performance becomes something that you really, really care about and you're willing to talk about because you do care about it. And it leads you in a whole new direction of thinking about the work, which is not, well, let's do what we think works, or do what people want us to do, or do what feels right, Purdue what we see an immediate sort of reaction or response to, but actually understanding what is really going to make the difference, what will really get us to that goal. And that is a new way of approaching work, and it's a very exciting thing. So I'll finish with this thought about accountability and autonomy. So we think about accountability as being external, and the loss of autonomy being loss of control to external forces. Nobody likes that. I don't like it. Nobody likes it, for good reason. But there's another type of autonomy, which is the autonomy to around choosing a course of action. And the sort of voluntary accountability I'm talking about, I suspect we fear in part because we are afraid of the consequences of committing to a goal, committing to a result. Because then you're looking at the evidence, you're looking at what is really happening because you care about it. And it might tell you something you don't want to know. And when it does, you're going to have to act on it. Because the goal, the value you're working towards is more important than doing this thing you really like to do. And everybody I've ever known in a foundation, myself included, have things we really like to do. A lot of times it's the things we know really well, the things we're experts in. And to find out sometimes that that's not what's making the difference and that something else is what's making the difference is painful. And I suspect that's part of the reason we fear the metrics. Because the metrics might tell us something we don't want.
Thank you very much, Dr. Matthews. Christy?
Good evening. Well, this topic is so timely for United Way and what we have been grappling with over the last few years. And I'd like to just take a couple minutes and set the stage on what we have been doing from both United Way worldwide level all the way to our local United Way at United Way of Central Indiana. So the United Way system has been around for over 100 years, and there's a lot of advantages to being around for 100 years, but there's also a lot of challenges. One of those challenges is over time, we have really been known or were thought about as a fundraising organization. So all of you probably, how many of you have participated or know about our annual campaign? The thermometer, yes. The annual goal. So that's really been what we have been known for. And over time, that's what people think of us. We are a fundraiser. And what we do with that money and the impact out in the community throughout, I think, the last few decades, I think we would say has been sort of secondary because it's been all about let's get those pledges signed, let's raise the money, let's meet the money goal. And so you can imagine if over time many of the societal problems that we have been investing money in for over 100 years still seem to be persistent. You can imagine that some of our major corporations that have been our partners for decades are wondering, if we are raising all of this money, then why aren't we seeing some of the big societal benchmarks, such as poverty and education and the like? Why isn't the needle moving on those? And those are tough questions for a system like United Way. And so we had to start looking inwardly as well and ask the same questions. Why aren't these societal needles moving? And so about 6 years ago, United Way Worldwide really led the charge for us to think differently about our work. And that instead of thinking of ourselves as a fundraiser and the end goal is to raise money and to hit that goal on the thermometer, to think of us more flip that argument and start thinking of ourselves as a community impact organization in which we use fundraising as a vehicle to impact the community. That's just one way that we do that. But there are other ways that we should be thinking about as well, and that is public policy, volunteer engagement, and in addition to fundraising. So we have been working on that for the last few years, and you can imagine to some of our donors and the agencies that we have been partners with for a long time, it is a very painful and scary conversation. Because they have felt that what our role is to go out and fundraise and invest in them, and that they worry about then the impact. So for us, over the last 2 years, we have been going through a process of trying to talk about how we are a community impact organization rather than a fundraising organization. So if you have been paying attention the last, or maybe noticed the last year or two, there have been no thermometers. Has anyone noticed that? There have been no thermometers in any of our corporate partners. We have not even announced a goal the last 2 years. Instead, we've announced big community goals over three or four areas in education, income, health, and basic needs. And we then have modified many of our processes, or starting to modify many of our processes internally and how we relate to the 91 agencies that we fund. How do they help impact those community impact goals? And we are modifying our funding mechanism to then reflect that. The more that they align with those goals, the more then we will likely be in a position to fund them. Along with that, there has to be metrics to measure that. And so we are also engaged with increasing our research capability and our strategic information capability to go alongside community impact so that we can start collecting the right data, as Dr. Prewitt was talking about, figuring out what data is actually available, what data helps us to monitor whether our agencies are helping us achieve our big goals, and then finally, if we can get a system to where we feel like we're confident it's telling that information to us, then we can, our plan is then to change our funding to invest into agencies and initiatives that are proven to impact the community. So those are all huge, big goals. I will tell you, it has not been without its, I don't want to say controversy, but a lot of feedback from our agencies. It's a very scary proposition for us to go down this kind of road with our agencies that have really been accustomed to depending on us for resources based on the last decades of our system. So we're in the middle of all of this. We don't know how it's all going to turn out over the next 3 years, but I would say that our staff is very aware that a lot of this is a hypothesis. We're testing out a lot of theories. I think we're pushing the envelope a lot on data collection and what is possible in terms of how do we use technology. And I am quite certain that some of our theories are not going to work out. So we have already started down the path of some theories. We've gotten feedback and have had to make some modifications. And so this idea about having enough space to to try out things and to be comfortable with failure, I think is going to be really important for us, and to be able to explain why a certain strategy that we thought would work, in fact, is not going to work, and we've had to readjust. So that's kind of where United Way is. We're in a unique position, I think, in that we are a grantee in a lot of situations. So we are getting money from foundations and donors who have certain expectations of us. And then we're also a grantor, where we're pushing down expectations and requirements to grantees. So we're playing both roles, and I think that puts us in a somewhat unique situation.
Thank you very much, Ms. Gillespie. Hearing both Dr. Matthews and Ms. Gillespie, I start wondering whose accountability matters, and see the power of setting your own goals, because if you don't, somebody might set them for you. So last but not least, Dr. Harold.
First, I'd like to thank the school for having me here today, for inviting me to provide my thoughts. It's a real honor to do so. Promote democratic political reform. Reduce social injustice and economic inequality. Protect human rights. Eliminate marginalization of minority populations. My research focuses on philanthropic foundations in the Middle East, and specifically, most recently, in Egypt. These are some of the goals of the Egyptian philanthropic foundations that I've researched. Curb global inequality. Unlock human potential. Cure disease. Create clean energy. Improve the world. These are some of the goals of US philanthropists and our own Lilly Family School of Philanthropy. In a recent New York Times essay suggests that technology leaders, who are also philanthropists on the West Coast, Silicon Valley-based philanthropists, believe that their giving is bolder, bigger, and more data-driven than anywhere else. Silicon Valley Community Foundation's president, Dr. Emmett Carson, is quoted as saying, "West Coast philanthropy is marked by innovation. It's about disruption. It's about change." Dr. Carson goes on to say, "We see the future today. You all see the future tomorrow." I guess that means that the West Coast philanthropists have double the amount of knowledge, but I don't think my arms stretch that far. These are lofty goals and lofty claims. They address some of society's most vexing challenges. And if foundations are bold enough to have these audacious goals, then I hope that they're bold enough to try to assess their progress toward those goals. But there are a number of challenges inherent in assessing performance, specifically when we're talking about social impact. Let me suggest a few. First, measurement is goal dependent. Perhaps we do need an accountability regime that is universal. I'm not sure that we have this yet, and I do believe that measurement will be, to a certain extent, goal dependent. Also, goals may change. In early February 2011, when former President Hosni Mubarak of Egypt was deposed, Egypt's foundations had a goal of leading civil society's political reform efforts. By 2014, their goal was to keep their doors open. The political environment for foundations for civil society was so repressive. So goals change, and goals are different. Measurement will therefore be goal dependent, and perhaps time dependent as well. Who defines success? Foundations? Grantees? Beneficiaries of service? causality. How do we know that a particular foundation's intervention impacted change that might have occurred? Presumably, there are many foundations, many organizations, many government entities working to address some of these vexing societal global challenges. How do we know that a specific foundation made a difference? Time. My interviewees in Egypt said that if there were to be a transition to democracy, we might see that transition in 10 to 15 years. And that was before the autocratic regime of President Sisi took power. And finally, resistance to candid feedback. I served as a fellow at the Center for Effective Philanthropy, and part of my job was to administer grantee perception reports. I visited foundations and gave them candid feedback from their grantees. Sometimes the feedback wasn't laudatory. I saw a range of responses from those program officers who were receiving the feedback. Some were grateful to have honest feedback, because those of us who have worked in foundations know that we've never had a bad lunch, we've never had a bad hair day, we've never told a bad joke. I tell them all the time, but I didn't when I worked in a foundation. So some program officers were very grateful for that candid feedback. Others cried, seriously, became angry, or just were in complete denial. So given these challenges to performance measurement, what can foundations do? Again, I do think this will be goal dependent, but I think that one universal strategy is to listen to grantees, to listen to beneficiaries. First, to fund grantee evaluations, or to support grantee evaluation with technical capacity, or with technical support, either financial or technical support. A recent Center for Effective Philanthropy study, just published in 2015, suggests that nonprofit organizations do want to measure their own performance. In a survey of 514 nonprofit leaders, 99% said that their organizations collect data. In an open-ended question about what they needed, what nonprofit organizations needed as they assessed their performance, half wanted more and better data. One-third wanted more resources for evaluation. Now, the typical nonprofit organization, according to the study, dedicates 2% or less of its budget to evaluation. And only one-third of nonprofit organizations in that study received foundation support, whether financial or technical, for their evaluations. So nonprofits are trying to assess their performance. They want to do so better, but only a third of them are receiving foundation support for that. So not only do I urge foundations to provide support, but also to read those reports. A blog post on the Center for Effective Philanthropy's website, an anonymous nonprofit organization or leader of a nonprofit organization is quoted as saying that they feel that their evaluation reports go into a giant, fiery furnace. Second, I urge foundations to solicit grantee feedback. The Center for Effective Philanthropy, and no, I'm no longer working for them, has a wonderful tool called the Grantee Perception Report. It solicits candid feedback from grantees on a variety of measures. A foundation's knowledge of the field, its impact on the field, whether it's a leader in the field, its relationships with grantees. Foundations, I think, need and deserve to know how their grantees feel that they're doing on these measures. This grantee report, I believe, or found a grantee perception report, provides valuable knowledge from the field on a foundation's assessment, provides candid feedback, reminds us that we do tell bad jokes and have bad hair days. So to conclude, foundations have audacious goals. It is important to try to evaluate their progress, to listen to grantees, to listen to the public that they are trying to serve, and to try to get a sense of whether these stakeholders, grantees, beneficiaries, feel like they are fortunate beneficiaries of foundations' largesse, or if they feel like they're bearing the brunt of foundation hubris. Dr. Prewitt mentioned that we are swimming in a quantification of everything. As I mentioned, by 2014, Egyptian foundations were simply trying to keep their doors open. They had audacious goals, but they also admitted that they didn't have all of the answers and that they didn't know the future. One admitted that often they were just muddling through. As they muddled through, they tried to listen to their grantees, and I hope we will too. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Harold. Well, let's give Dr. Prewitt a chance to respond to these wonderful comments.
I don't need to say much. They're highly consistent with, I think, the drift of what I want to suggest. You take the United Way Courageous Act, and because it illustrates something, if they try to do this, there will be losers. There will be people who don't have much impact, and they've been favored grantees for a very long time, and there will be losers, and they're going to complain. They're going to complain about the system that's put in place. They're going to challenge the nature of the data, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And if, because of that, contributions to United Way begin to shrink, then, you've committed institutional suicide. So there's a real stake. And I want to mention that I will state it, of course, but we don't know by how much. I want to mention that because, to go to the question of the Voluntary Act, it seems to me, I think what Duane said is very important, very interesting. Obviously, there can be voluntary accountability. The question is, are there any costs to not getting there? And you put in place something where the cost is actually institutional survival, if I can overstate it, but it's that kind of situation. So that means the temptation to cheat is overwhelming.
Yes.
In how you actually do it. All the incentives are against sort of setting yourself up for that kind of pain, that kind of cost. That's why I said these criteria have to be met. If you're gaming the system, then of course you can voluntarily assess yourself, and guess what? You got to control and so forth and so on. I didn't use the word as much as I should have when I was talking about accountability. It's got to be negotiated. It's not something that's imposed from the outside. It's not something created from the inside. It's something that emerges in a conversation. It is a negotiated regime. Both sides think that they're going to be, that the game is, the playing field has been leveled out. So I guess, quickly on Catherine's points, the challenges are immense. I don't mean to minimize the challenges at all in any of this stuff. I just know if we don't do it, the cost are at least for taxpayer dollars, whether it's going to creep into the foundation world by the guardians of the quality of foundations, for which is also a government responsibility, of course, it's harder to say. But certainly research universities and places that actually do try to get money, taxpayer dollars, it's going to be imposed from the outside if it's not negotiated. So I part of my point is I think we all have to voluntarily step up, but against some criteria, which I tried to very vaguely thing. So I don't want to go on at great length. These were all, they seem to me to make the point that we're all struggling to put in place something that's not quite in place. And we have to know that getting it right is difficult, that getting it right, if it is really right, then there has got to be the possibility that you don't measure up. And if you don't measure up, then there's a real price to pay for the people who don't measure up. So I just to finish off with the voluntary accountability, I don't know what happens in 2025 to the foundation if you didn't make it. I don't know what the cost is. It sort of gets lost in the, you know, yeah, we didn't, like, you know. So I'm going to end up with an anecdote. My wife's an art historian. For a while, she was the director of the Yale Art Gallery. And she took on that job. She was supposed to be doing some major new building strategies and so forth and so on. And she found out that the very, very important donor had given to, and he and his wife had given to the Yale Art Gallery, some classic, really important paintings from the Revolutionary War era, Washington crossing the Delaware and things like that. And they are all in their special gallery. And so the question was that special gallery still going to be there after the renovations and so forth? Then she found out that the donors were buried in a crypt underneath this gallery. And that the terms of the will of this artwork was that our bodies have to remain adjacent to, underneath, whatever the things are hung. So if she was going to move the pieces, then they were going to have to move the body. So it's an engineering problem, but not built. That's not the kicker. The kicker is that if Yale breaks any aspect of this will, the art goes to Harvard. So my point is, you've got to set up some sort of external a price, or it
doesn't matter.
If the price is you're going to lose your art to Yale, guess what? I mean, Harvard, guess what? Be really, really careful. So that's, for all of this stuff, we've got to take it really seriously in terms of how we try to present it, how we try to negotiate it, how we try to frame it. And if it doesn't have a cost, it's probably not serious. It's probably just one more shell game we're playing, and I think if we play the shell game, we're going to get in trouble.
It's a terrific anecdote, and I know the horror of Harvard at Yale, so that's terrible. So I think we have time for a few questions if anybody wants to raise their hands and engage, either Dr. Prewitt or any of our panel members. Sir.
Following up on Dr. Prewitt's question about...
Can you just identify yourself?
Sure. Dan Boots. I'm with the Advancement Center for Washington Township Schools and of the North Central Alumni Association. Following up on Dr. Prewitt's point about the losers in the policymaking, and particularly with the United Way situation, typically those ideas of prioritizing societal needs and what is an effective agency is the critical role of the government. Do you feel that United Way has the tools and resources to make those decisions? And I assume that's part of your big corporate challenge of being teaching yourselves to even pursue that process.
That's a great question. Actually, we have had various systems in place for a very long time evaluating agencies. What I would say on the organizational strength side, so evaluating their financial strength, their management, and their governance. We have done a little bit in the area of more community impact, because we've always collected demographics, like who are they serving, how many people are they serving, and things like that. So we've always had an evaluation process in place, and in particular, over the last 8 years, that system has actually become fairly rigorous over time. So I feel like we're really good at assessing organizational strength standards with our agencies. And so in this process, as we're changing our strategies to more community impact, we are really focusing in on results and response to community and impact. And so that's really the part that we need to improve in terms of our evaluation system. Now, the other point I want to make about that, and this is one point that we've tried to say over and over to our agencies and to our donors, is that we have set specific community-wide goals that that we're pursuing in education, income, health, and basic needs. And when we evaluate whether our agencies align with those, that part of our evaluation is not a statement on whether what that agency is doing is a great thing for the public good. It is merely evaluating how well do they align with the goals that we have chosen. And so it's very possible that there will be great organizations that we've had a relationship for a very long time who are doing fantastic work that's important to the community, but they may not align with the community goals that we have chosen, if that makes sense. And so we've really tried to make sure that there is a differential, that part of our evaluation of whether they're aligning with United Way is not a statement about whether they're a good or bad organization. So hopefully that helps.
Yes, sir.
My name's Lynn Gordon. I'm a board member of the Kendrick Foundation. It's a private foundation in Morgan County. We have an all-volunteer board, similar to, we are being very becoming much more strategic in the way that we award our grants. We've gone through a strategic planning process, but my question is, what is the length of time, because there will be losers in our grantees from the methodology we've been using, what is the appropriate amount of time to soften that transition for the losers?
That's a fair question, and I think the dean of the School of Philanthropy should. Ask one of your students who's got to write a dissertation.
Does anybody want to raise their hand and take an attempt at this? My off the top of my head reaction would be that it's not really the length of time, but it's creating the expectation so that it's not a surprise is the most important thing. So I'm sure your grantees are aware of the fact that you're going through strategic planning process and starting to signal that, knowing kind of the possibly kind of the business cycle, if you will, the funding cycle of your organizations, and just not making it a surprise. And to Dr. Harold's point, you know, listen to your grantees and include them in the conversation is the way I would guess. But maybe other analysts have other responses.
I can just share with you what we're doing to help prepare our grantees, or our agencies. We have tried really hard to be completely transparent. So the minute our board voted a year and a half ago on kind of the plan that filled in the details, we held a meeting 2 days later with all the agency executives and kind of walked through what our 3 to 5 year plan was. We have, for the last two summers, have held small group kind of focus groups with our agencies and just a myriad of outreach opportunities. We've also tried to set up opportunities where the board chairs can come, and we have also offered staff to go out to attend board meetings. And what we said to our agency execs were, we don't want you to be in the position where you have to interpret what we're doing. We don't want you to have to speak for us and then answer questions that you don't feel equipped to answer. So we will do that for you because we don't want to put you in that position. It's taken a lot of staff time, and at first, I will tell you, we wondered, is this the right thing to do? Because obviously it's taking us away from other work. But after 15 months of implementing all these different outreach strategies, I am convinced we did the right thing, even though it took a lot of time and effort and managing a lot of meetings and meeting invites and schedules. It was worth it. So we're going to continue to do that. I think it's helped manage the anxiety, but the anxiety is still there, and it's been really hard to walk the fine line of being transparent and upfront, but also calming, keeping people calm, because you don't want them to get so anxiety-ridden that they can't even perform, and acknowledging that there will be losers, because the minute you do that, then they start thinking, well, is the loser going to be me? And it's very, very hard. So that's what we've done.
Thank you.
Well, on that note, maybe we'll allow one student to be heard from. So Rebecca, last question.
My name is Rebecca Buxton. I'm a master's student here at the School of Philanthropy. And I wanted to direct a question to Dr. Prewitt and would love to hear feedback from other panelists as well. But since the BOOSBAR acronym is yours, in the master's program, we've been fortunate to study civil society. And one of the themes that we've taken from that is the concept, which I'm sure you and other panelists are familiar with, of the importance of social capital and trust in a society that is progressing towards improvement. So I'm curious if you could articulate somehow how the USBAR approach would be able to contribute to that sense of civil society, of building social capital, building increasing trust among various stakeholders or pieces of society.
I'd like to first say that I don't think we have time for commentary on what I'm about to say, so so I'll feel liberated to put it some other way. Because I'm now going to sort of contradict myself at some level. The thing that most worries me about the performance metric stuff attached to accountability, in the way that I described that I think we have to move in that direction, is it takes a judgment out of the system. You basically are replacing what had been a system based upon judgment. See, if you take scientific funding, for example, scientific funding has been based on peer review. It's a judgment that the peers are making, this is a good investment of money and so forth and so on. I'm really, really deeply worried that if we shrink judgment and replace it with numeric targets and goals and so forth, that somehow we've lost something. We've lost something about a feel for the society, a feel for what we're about, and so forth. So I would say about something like social capital and trust, we can invent some metric about how many people, blah, 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 and I wouldn't want it. I would really rather bring a group of wise people into the room at the end of the day and say, what do you think? Do you think that we have created a new kind of community here which has higher levels of tolerance and trust than we had when we started? And we will just decide on the basis of not whether there's going to be a price if we didn't meet some target or anything, but just, so I would say don't push this thing. Don't let the system push beyond its capacity to do a good job at it. And on that, I think we can't do it. I don't think we really quite understand social capital completely and the process by which it emerges. I think after the fact, we sort of know it. But I would not look for numbers. I would look for wise people whose judgment you would trust. And maybe they're poets. And maybe they're historians. And maybe they're not kind of quote-unquote scientists at all, who have a feel for this, you know, for this kind of stuff. So that's the last word I'd like to make sure, even though I'm convinced that all this is in our future, it's not necessarily unvarnished a benefit. It's got some real downsides, and you've got to sort of identify those downsides and try to correct for them, you know, as we go. That's a real job for a school of philanthropy. That's a real job for careers in philanthropy as you go forward from your MA, which I'm sure you will successfully, and so forth and so on. But wait a minute. Yes, I agree, but here's one of the prices the society might pay, and let's not lose it. And I would say judgment and quality of thinking and so forth.
Well, on that great last word of judgment, please join me in thanking Dr. Prewitt and our terrific panel.